you seen those weird cat? I forgot, Crunchy. Did I show you those weird Cadbury commercials?
You sure did.
Yeah, well, the new place I moved into has, like, a lot of little rabbits running around the, like, area. So Drax was teasing me about catching one of them.
I'm bored.
I was like, take it easy. Can you give me Caramel's number? I'll let you go then. No. Bad Robbie. Let's see. That wouldn't be taking it easy.
Not in the slightest.
Keo, you're the guy who knows everything about, like, video game bullshit. You need to help me. Oh, never mind. I may be able to now.
What?
No. What? No! Yeah, I don't know how I'm supposed to get there. I had the jump potion. It did not help me. I think I might need the speed one. It's the only one I can think of that... You know what? I'm gonna cheat. I'm gonna look it up.
Audible gasp.
Okay. Seemingly that one area I was trying to get to in the previous level that I wasn't able to and kind of just gave up on. That's where the feather was. Dole. Okay, so this... Yeah, pretty much getting the blue potion seems like about the only way to do it.
Oh, good.
And it says defeat fireballs until the blue potion shows up.
What fun.
It's like either that or I can try getting a bubble to somehow perfectly go through there. Jeez Louise. This game. I love this game, but man, it's got some bullshit.
It's really mean sometimes.
Let's shuffle. Can't touch this. Do.
The shuffle is so good.
No, wrong potion. Part of me is just like, just go try the bubble trick. And I'm like, yeah, but the moment I go down there, blue potion's probably gonna show up. You gave me another pink potion. God fucking damn this game.
It just really likes pink, okay?
Give me a blue.
Yeah, any day now.
I'm blue.
Da-ba-dee-ba-da. And man, imagine how hot
Fuck yeah. Come on. Yes!
Be in there, boys.
My boy. I now have the red. Okay, that actually wasn't too bad of a weight, all things considered.
Still sucked, though.
Yeah. I won't argue that. I'm just glad it wasn't near as bad as I was afraid it was going to be.
10,000 years later.
Like in Ghosts and Goblins, if you don't get the... If you get something that's not the dagger, and you want to get the dagger again, so you keep fighting enemies after enemies after enemies.
And some of the weapons are just like, please, what? This weapon, there's no way they made this weapon and didn't say, this is a weapon that you pick up and it is actually a downgrade in every sense of the word.
You mean like the torch?
The torch, is, at least in SG&G, is actually not awful. It's far from the worst weapon.
But in the original Ghosts and Goblins, it's pretty painful.
Yeah,
Ghosts and Goblins, definitely. Anything other than the knife is pretty much a pain.
Yeah, the knife is solid. The lance isn't bad, but it's just you can't have as many on screen as you can with the knife.
Yeah. The shield sucks, but it makes you use it, so.
You may do with what you got. Galadriel, maybe? Yeah. I haven't seen it. I can't read it yet. Let's see. It's Galadriel.
That's a name?
Yeah.
Okay. I've never heard of it.
I have. I couldn't tell you where, though. I think it's definitely one of those disused names.
So pretty much most every name in this game.
Except maybe Penelope.
Yeah, except for Penelope. Yeah, Penelope's one that... That's why I'm still like... That's a weird choice, because that's a name that I actually wouldn't be surprised to hear somebody called that.
Well, to be fair, I can't actually remember the last time I've met someone named Penelope.
I think usually they'll go by Penny. Because I knew someone named Penny, and I'm pretty sure that was probably her full name, was probably Penelope.
Maybe her name was Pendragon!
Or Pim Dragon, as I've been... Some people have been calling me recently, which I approve.
That just reminds me of a story I've heard back in high school. We had a teacher saying, yeah, so it's my job to write the calligraphy on the diplomas. And we had a guy who we always just called him Joe. Yeah, that's what he asked to be called, so everyone just called him Joe. And we never really thought about it much until he rang the diplomas. And so, you know, I was writing his diploma and I wrote Joseph. And then he came up and said, sorry, but you're going to have to change it. That's not actually what it's short for. Well, what is Joe short for then? Jehoshaphat.
Whoa!
Damn, that's biblical right there.
Yeah.
Oh, Kyo, sorry you missed it. We figured it out.
I had a nephew named whose name is Elijah. It's the closest I've got to getting biblical. Let's see. Well, no, but it's like Griselda, though, is like, I think, the next princess we save, and the only time I've heard that name is like for like a witch.
Oh, Drax came through. Galadriel was the name of the High Elf in Lord of the Rings that has one of the three elf rings and gives Frodo the Flask of Light.
Oh, shit. There you go. And then Frodo stole the bong, and Sam killed him. Oh, wait.
Yeah. I read the Silmarillion like once a trillion years ago, and I remember nothing from it.
I'll stick to Joel of Vinesauce's version of the Lord of the Rings when he played the Tex Avenger. Frodo stole the bong and Sam killed him.
Oh. Boy, that sounds like a freaking modern AU Lord of the Rings. it could only be more stereotypical fanfiction if it were like in a freaking coffee shop.
Look, I've got a cloak of invincibility, and yet enemies still see me and attack me. See?
Drax, you're right. I don't doubt you're right, but I'm gonna let you know a little secret. I never much cared for Lord of the Rings. I read them all, but it never really grabbed me the way some other books do.
I'll be honest. I've only watched the movies.
The books are worth a read at least once.
There's
definitely a lot more there than it's in the movies, but even with that, it was never one that just really said, you know what, I want to read this more than once and like really get into the fandom. It never really did it for me in that sense.
I'll be honest, I think I tried to read, like, the book, and it was just kind of like, try.
I did like The Hobbit, though. The Hobbit I actually did read more than once, but the actual Lord of the Rings trilogy and Silmarillion were... I did not enjoy nearly as much.
Panic attack.
Doesn't help that the Fellowship is incredibly long. That book is so long.
Alright, got 2 out of 3. Ooh, more. Oh no! I don't need the Clone of Darkness again.
You don't need it, but you're getting it anyway.
I'll get the Wand of Wonder instead, even though it's also useless. Oh look, I can freeze the enemies instead of killing them. How helpful. Especially when these enemies take just one hit. I froze the snake and it still moved!
Yes, Drax, I actually did. I remember when I was younger that a old Cartoon Network would actually air those almost, like, I swear to God, at least once a month, so I actually watched those a lot.
What?
The Hobbit and the Lord of the Rings cartoons. Oh. Okay, let me phrase it. I saw they always aired The Hobbit and Return of the King. They never actually aired the Lord of the Rings one that was done by
Ralph
someone
Bakshi
different.
One?
That's right, that was Ralph Bakshi, wasn't it?
Yes.
That one I haven't actually seen. I've only seen the Hobbit and the Return of the King, which were done in that same style. I can't remember who did those though.
Rankin Bass.
Was that Rankin Bass?
Yeah, it was Rankin Bass.
Oh. Okay, yeah, I've seen those. Many times, in fact. Let's see.
I remember those being good, but I haven't seen them in a long time, so...
I do need to see the Bakshi one at some point, because I heard it's actually really good.
It's okay. It's as okay as, like, trying to cram the entire book series into one movie can be. And done by
Which
Bakshi.
Yeah.
With lots of weird rotoscoping and live-action footage superimposed on animated footage.
Yeah, whatever floated his boat, I guess.
Well, in his defense, I can't... A lot of the weirdness in that movie was not his fault. Originally, it was just going to be the first book, and they were told halfway through production that it had to be the entire series.
Nice.
Yeah. And also got a budget cut, so...
That sounds about right with what happens with that sort of thing.
Sounds about right with what seems to happen with Bakshi in general. Why'd my Mighty Mouse TV series get canceled? Supposedly because people thought he was snorting cocaine.
But his interview pretty much said the reason it got canceled was because of Fritz the Cat, and I don't disagree with that.
Yeah.
Because for better or worse, that's the movie that's forever attached to his name, and regardless of what everything else he's made between then and now, that's just what everyone associates with him.
Yeah. I still do love his comment on John Chris Belushi, though.
I taught him to be an asshole.
Yeah, John Chris Belushi's an asshole. I know because I taught him how to be an asshole. I don't know, one interview he just said, well, maybe if, like, Chris Belushi didn't make Mighty Mouse snort coke, I would have still had a cartoon show. But it's kind of hard to... With how bitter Bakshi is, it's hard to tell when he's kidding and when he's being fucking serious, so...
Yeah, I don't know. It's one of those things where he's had a career that a lot of people would be envious of. But at the same time, you can't blame him for being bitter because of pretty much the fact that what is debatably his biggest achievement is also the thing that he drags around his neck like an anchor.
Yeah, that happens to seemingly that happens to a lot of people, both actors and artists alike.
Yeah, I guess it's like the animation equivalent of getting typecast.
Yeah. Adam West, for the longest time, couldn't get work because he was so good at being Batman.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, a lot of other really good animators... I'm hard-pressed to think of many other animators that have that same problem. Like, for example, you think of someone like Don Bluth. Like, he has so many things attached to his name that he's not like really bound by any one of them.
No, but he had... actually, Titan A.E. Was a big problem for him. he couldn't get work for the longest time because of how bad Titan IAE did.
Which is unfortunate, because that was more so just a shifting in animation, the public's animation wants, rather than the movie being bad.
Oh, that movie had a bunch of production problems.
Yeah, and that's true, but I don't know. That's probably one of those movies where, in hindsight, it's not, it's, time has, softened the blow to a point.
I think the best thing is to watch that with commentary, and every time the CG and the, like, 2D animation mesh horribly, you can just hear an audible groan from Don Bluth. But yeah, that movie had a bunch of production problems. Originally, Don Bluth wasn't even on it. He got put on it whenever the first character designer and animator dropped out or something like that. So he got put on last minute onto that project.
And given the way Don Bluth like does things, he's one of the things where if he's not on it from the start, it's just it can be rough.
Well, that and he only supervised the 2D animation. Somebody else was doing all the 3D stuff.
Hence the groans.
Yeah, and thus the 2D looks really good in that movie. It's just the meshing with the 3D is really not so good. But yeah, see, that was like one of the weird things about that movie was that they had like these action figures released for it, and none of them looked anything like the designs that were in the movie, and that was why.
That's funny. Unfortunate, but funny.
Yeah. Honestly, I think it's a good movie. It's a good movie if you can get past some stuff. I mean, I like a lot of the dialogue in it. Like at the end, it's like, what are we going to name the planet? I think we should name it Bob. How about Earth 2? No, we should name it Bob. And it's like, Planet Bob in parentheses Earth 2.
All I remember about Titan AE was that at the time, I thought it looked really cool because science fiction has always been my genre of choice. And I'm just like, this looks really cool. I really want to see it. But I seem to remember that at the time, my parents were like, yeah, movies are really expensive. We're not going to go see that. And I was like, oh.
Yeah, that. Heck, even like when Disney made a sci-fi movie that I thought was freaking awesome, it didn't do well. Treasure Planet,
which is a fantastic movie, but again, it was during an era where traditional animation was seen as out of date.
See, and it's real pity because I fucking love that movie. So
no, it's a great movie, like with good great animation, just great sense of humor, and just a lot of interesting characters.
The only thing I don't like about that movie is Martin Short's character, which is Ben the Robot, who is freaking obnoxious. But of course, he's obnoxious. It's Martin Short, and I just killed a leprechaun.
It's a robot sidekick? That never happens.
See, I love the dog guy in it, though. I think his name was, like, Dogbird or something. He was like,
yeah, I don't remember his name,
but
he
looked weirdly
yeah.
out of place. He looked like freaking Goofy's, like, future ancestor or something.
Future ancestor?
Oh. What do you call someone from the future that's related to you?
Past descendant.
Really?
No, not really. Descendant.
Okay. He looks like a descendant of Goofy. But he was like the best character. I love his... It's just... It's like... It's like... Jim, I'm a doctor, not a... Well, I am a doctor, but not that kind of doctor.
Dang it, Jim, I'm an astronomer, not a doctor. I mean, I am a doctor, but I'm not that kind of doctor. I have a doctorate. It's not the same thing. You can't help people with a doctorate. You just sit there and you're useless.
Yes.
Or the scene where he just gets out of the ropes is great, because he's like, he's just kind of like, I'm useless. There's nothing I can do to help. And seemingly, I have really thin wrists. It's just delivered so excellently.
Here's a thought. You have everyone's gushing about freaking Toy Story in Kingdom Hearts 3. Where's my freaking Treasure Planet world in Kingdom Hearts 3?
Amen, brother. Preach it. Pixar just seems. I love Pixar and I love Toy Story, but that's just Something seems weird about that for some reason. But then again, what am I talking about? They had freaking Pirates of the Caribbean in Part 2, so never mind.
Yeah, it's I don't know, it's one of those things where it's been at least 10 years since I stopped trying to give a shit about any sort of story or cohesion to what's going on in Kingdom Hearts.
I'm gonna laugh if, like, Woody just looks at Sora and is like, "You are a toy!"
Yeah, I've seen edits that are like that. But that's not quite as good as the hint. It's like, "Sorry, you have to figure out a plan. Oh my god, is that a Heartless?" And he does the thing where he's just pointing and laughing.
Oh, I got the feather I missed now.
Yay! Now you can be floaty!
Like, this game wasn't floaty enough.
The jumping is a little bit clunky and floaty. What do we do? Make it floatier. You heard me. Okay.
Weirdly, one game I did actually ponder playing at one point was another game made by Rare, but it was nowhere near as good as this.
Which one?
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Oh my god.
Rare was kind of like the fucking butt monkeys of the, like, Nintendo era or something, because they always got, like, some really crap projects when you think about it.
Well, it's kind of like early way forward. It's like, they have projects they want to work on, but in order to have the money to work on them, they gotta do stuff that just pays the bills.
Yeah. So they did, I got my Boots of Force back. Fuck yeah. So, yeah, instead they have to do stuff like Nightmare on Elm Street and Beetlejuice for LKN.
Oh my god.
Though, I will defend at least Nightmare on Elm Street on the factor that I will say this. If that game was not called Nightmare on Elm Street, I bet people wouldn't be so would be more forgiving of it.
Possibly.
Because if it was just like a normal, like, haunted house sort of game, why did they change the enemies from the first level randomly?
I don't know. Also, hi, Blueprint.
And now they're back. But yeah, it's just, to me, it's not a terrible game, I'll say that. It's got problems, and it's not great, but it's not bad, but it's definitely, you know, putting something like Nightmare on Elm Street on it and expecting people to take it seriously, it's just when you have like Frankensteins and ghosts and stuff running around it, it's just kind of. Yeah, if it was just its own thing, I think most people would have just been like, eh, it's a pretty good game. I actually like the Friday the 13th game, I hate to say. Is it a good game? No, but I think it has a lot of interesting ideas in it.
Yeah, I think Penelope. I think that's one of the things that when I have these discussions with people, and they'll be like, "Oh, this game is really good," and I'm like, "No, how can you say that?" It's like, "No, I love that game. It's really good." No, did you like the game? Because liking the game, and the game being good, do not necessarily correlate.
Yeah, I have to tell people about that on games and cartoons all the time.
Like, so you like the game, fine. Great, like that game. Like the heck out of it. Don't let anyone give you shit for that. But don't try to convince me it's good.
Yes. That's why I say, it's like, is Friday the 13th a good game? No. Does it have some interesting or good ideas? Yes. But that still doesn't make it good. Because the thing that I think is interesting about it is when you think about it, it's got a lot of the things that kind of... It's got a lot of the... kind of starting blocks to what would later become a survival horror game.
Well, as much as you could get on, you know,
the NES. Like I said, it's got the starting blocks. There's, like, ideas there. They're just not implemented very well.
Yeah. Well, it is kind of cool to me, just from a development standpoint, to see that survival horror is a thing that you can totally do that you don't need, like, live instrumentation, voiceover, and like 3D graphics. People have done surprisingly potent survival horror with even low-res graphics and things like that.
And like I said, when I was a kid, and Jason would randomly pop up, because you'd just, like, be looking around the cabin, and just he'd appear. That scared the shit out of me.
Yeah.
It was, like, a jump scare before that was even, like, a thing. Well, a common thing, I guess would be the better phrasing for it.
Right.
Before FNAF made him boring.
FNAF killed jump scares, you heard it here last.
I can make fun of that because I actually like FNAF, but...
Well, that's one of those things. When you really like something, you feel comfortable making fun of it, because it's kind of like, I love this, but it, by God, it's sure is goofy, or this part of it sure is bad, or...
Yeah. Well, I think that's part of liking something. I mean, some people think that if you like it, you have to think it's, like, perfect, and that's... I don't think that's a case. You should be...
No, not at all. That's actually one of the biggest problems I have with the Die Hard Sonic fandom.
Sonic's got problems.
It's like, I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, I've met a lot of fantastic people through the fandom, and I'm still part of it, but it's like, guys, you don't have to like everything. If it's something as bad, you're allowed to not like it and still be a fan.
Yeah. It's like, I love Sonic, but Sonic Adventure 1 and 2 have not aged very well.
They're still fun, but by golly, you really start to see some of the age creases in its face now.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like I know a lot of people that like refuse to acknowledge that that game's aged badly, or that there's even problems with that game, and I'm like, dude, that game's got a lot of problems. Look, I like that game, but it's aged bad.
Yeah.
And that happens. Not every game can be like, you know, most of the Mario games.
Yeah, and that's the other thing. It's like, ignoring something's problems or blatantly just disregarding them or defending something that doesn't need to be defending isn't doing the series you love any favors.
Yeah. I mean, that's... Actually, I think what the biggest problem Sonic was having for a while is games felt like they were taking what they learned and advancing upon them. It kind of felt like Sonic was staying as Sonic Adventure 2 with a lot of the sequels and not learning from it.
Yeah, and then for a little while the problem was different. They kept trying to change too much every game. It's like you don't have enough time to improve on what you learn with the formula. Unleashed Colors Generations. But at that point, yeah, you got that formula down pretty well. That's good. Work with that. And they're like, no, we're just going to start completely from scratch. And Lost World was a game that was my biggest disappointment of that year.
I still have not played that. I think I actually...
Don't.
I think I have it on Steam.
Actually, no, I shouldn't say don't. But, I mean, just go into it with the idea that it's not going to be anything like what you expect. Because I went in there expecting... really looking forward to it, and... I think I've made actually Toy Story. I went in there really excited, but I actually literally bought a Wii U specifically for it. I played it, I streamed it for several hours the first night, then I turned it off, and I was not able to play another video game for a week.
Wow. That's... Damn.
To be fair, they patched it and it improved the experience somewhat, but even though I've since gone back and beaten it, I have no desire to go back and... like try to improve my times or do anything like that. I'm just like, I beat the game, I can put it on my shelf and just that's it.
Oh, there you go.